Yes, there are some in the more recent years beginning to offer a few lectures, if you will, but it's just kind of a smattering of nutrition information. So physicians are really not being taught nutrition. So we're missing it from the application of medicine as well as from the research background that supports that application. So I don't need to show that picture. That's what we're talking about here, a whole food plant-based diet. Lots of color, good taste, and all the rest. Now, in here, I do want to clarify some terminology because unfortunately there's a lot of sort of discussion about nutrition in the public, and there's an increasing and growing awareness of this idea of eating plant-based foods, for sure. But we're operating from slightly different perspectives at times, and I think this can be confusing. I'm going to suggest that I'm not talking about vegetarianism, really. When I started my career, I didn't even know the word, and in fact, I went through most of my research career really not giving a lot of attention to what vegetarianism was really all about. But even today, unfortunately, vegetarians kind of going in the right direction, I would suggest, in a sense. On the other hand, 90% are still using dairy and fish and eggs off and on. And the effect of food on health is best described by the nutrient composition of that food. Yeah, how much protein, how much fat, how much antioxidant, how much fiber, all that sort of thing. That's the way we learn what food can do in terms of all those nutrients, if you will. Well, vegetarians, when they're using dairy, some fish and some eggs, the nutrient composition of the vegetarian diet is not that different from the non-vegetarian diet. So therefore, we do see some advantages, some health advantages for vegetarianism, but not near what we could see. Because 90%, as I say, are still using pretty generous amounts of the wrong kind of food. Vegan. I hadn't heard of the word veganism until late in my career, as a matter of fact, and I'm grateful for the fact that the vegan community has taken a great deal of interest in the work that we've been doing, and people like to characterize our approach, if you will, as veganism. I never even used the word once in the China study. The vegan approach is fine and dandy. A lot of people who chose a vegan way of eating, of course, did it for ethical reasons, a great reason, a sustaining reason, I would argue. On one hand, it's all good stuff, going into that direction. But I'm not talking about the vegan diet because, coming back to the nutrient composition of food, the average fat content, the fat content of the average vegan diet is 30% of total calories. 30% of total calories. I'm talking about a diet very differently. And so vegans tend to choose diets that are too high in fat, number one. Number two, vegans, like the rest of us, who don't pay a lot of attention to the science, they tend to have too much of the refined carbohydrates, sugar and white flour and things like that. So you've probably heard of the term junk food vegans. That's a problem. So I want to point this out, because when you hear about evidence about health benefits of a vegan diet, for example, from time to time you might see in the press, it doesn't look all that impressive, and so some of the people opposed to what we're doing will jump on it. We don't get the kind of results that we can get. Well, it's true. The vegan diet is better. We can see some advantages, there's no question, and even, quite frankly, a little bit better than vegetarianism, because they're avoiding all animal foods. That's point number one. That's a good thing. But in reality, because they are also using in those foods the high fat, high complex refined carbohydrate, they're not getting the bang for the buck that they could get. And I do want to make that distinction, because that's why I kind of like the idea of whole food, plant-based. And it's an awkward term. I know that. It's a really awkward term. I'm the one that first came up with that when I was working with the National Institutes of Health group. We were the ones sort of deciding who gets funding and who doesn't at the time. And I was the only nutritionist on that cancer research group. So now it's been 30 years ago when I started to have to describe, what's all this about plants? And I was thinking, vegetarian, So I did promote that term, whole food plant-based, because it was based on the evidence, essentially, in the nutrient content. So I'm talking about something a little different than vegan or vegetarianism. Not about nutrient supplements either. You know, we have, through the years, through the last, what, three decades at least, maybe four, a lot of people hear, you know, that nutrition is pretty important. They want to know something about it. Foods, you know, can maybe prevent cancer and heart disease and so forth and so on. They kind of turn their attention, thanks to a lot of encouragement from the industry, they kind of turn their attention to using nutrient supplements as a means to get that nutrition. That doesn't work. It really doesn't work. That's not nutrition. I suggest that's pharmacology. Using nutrient supplements is more like pharmacology. So brings it back again to this central idea is the whole food, like you've been eating here for your dinner this evening. I'd like to point this out too, because the nutrient supplement industry is now in the neighborhood of between $30 and $40 billion a year in terms of the products they're producing. And you know, the vast majority of people are using more than half, and I don't know whether it's going down there or not, but actually they have been using a lot of different supplements. It's also, of course, not the low-carb diet. In fact, the whole food plant-based diet is really high in carbohydrate, really high. So we're talking about a high-carb diet, not a low-carb diet. The low-carb folks, like Dr. Atkins and Dr. Agatson, who did the Southeast diet, the paleo diet, the zone diet, all those diets have been advocating the idea, if we could just cut down carbohydrate, we could solve our problems. Part of that story is correct. They were correct in one way. That is, if we cut down the sugars and white flours, that's a good deal. There's some truth in that. There's evidence to support that without a doubt. There's no question about that. But they kind of use that low-carb vernacular, if you will, that terminology to refer to carbohydrates in general. So if you cut down total carbohydrate in a diet, then that's exactly the opposite of what we're talking about, because all the carbohydrates we get come from plants. So by talking about a low-carb diet and using that term rather loosely, what they're really doing is they're trying to discredit the whole food plant-based diet. That's their game plan. And so when you use it, if you're going to be serious about a low-carb diet, that means all carbohydrates, it has to be filled up then with protein or fat. That's exactly the opposite. We get problems because of that. There's just a sort of graphic illustration of what I just mentioned here. If we're talking about carbohydrate only from plants, carbohydrates are plant-based substances, basically. There's a tiny little bit for your biochemist, as you know, glycogen in the liver and muscle and so forth. That's meaningless as far as the total carbohydrate content is concerned. So the whole food plant-based diet, we're talking about 75 to 80% carbohydrate. Somewhere in that neighborhood just works just fine. The low carb diet, like 15 to 20. Opposite ends of the spectrum. And we get opposite effects, essentially, in the long term, for sure. On the other hand, as I said before, the low carb diet, in terms of that protein, basically coming from animal foods for the most part, 80 to 85% of the total energy intake of low-carb diet is that protein. So they're way up here. Hopefully plant-based diet is down there, about 20% or so. It can't be more if it's coming from plants, but nonetheless, we're talking about a huge difference between the low-carb diet on one hand and the high-carb, whole food plant-based diet on the other. So I want to suggest something here that might not have been considered too much, certainly not enough, I should say. There's two problems with present day, coming back to this concept of nutrition. There's two problems, basically, that I sort of think are important. One is that our consumption of protein is too high. Just think about protein in general. We've been a society for decades, even for more than a century, believing the more protein we can get, the better we're going to be. Now, for most people, that meant protein only comes from animal foods. In fact, meat and protein are kind of synonymous, if you think of that. That's what it's been for years. So most people have considered protein to be special, really special. And they got that idea from the point of view of the necessity of eating meat. And of course, dairy came along, does the same thing, and eggs. So in any case, without getting into all the nitty gritty, the policy and the history of that necessarily, I want to emphasize that point for the moment, illustrate something about it. So protein consumption is overemphasized. It has been throughout history. Protein was discovered in 1839 as a substance by a Dutch chemist. In fact, he found this compound at the time that was good for feeding dogs. It was necessary for the health of dogs. So they gave a name to it because they said it was so important. And they chose the Greek word proteios, P-R-O-T-E-I-O-S, which means of prime importance. So the word protein comes from the Greek, was basically, that substance was really baptized, of prime importance. Ever since 1839, the idea of consuming protein as much as we can get has been on the minds of everyone. And for those of you who have made a transition, let's say you've certainly been asked the question, I'm sure, where do you get your protein from? And I'm going to suggest this is the number one scientific observation that has really distorted meaning and understanding of the entire concept of nutrition. I'll elaborate on that a little bit more in a moment. Otherwise, you're jumping ahead. The second thing, nutrient supplement, I already mentioned that. So there's two, in my all the years of my experience with doing experimental research, there's two things that's kind of stood out that's caused a lot of confusion. It's our too much emphasis on protein and our use of protein on one hand, and on the other hand, at least in more recent two or three decades, too much emphasis given to nutrient supplements and letting the rest of our diet go. The idea being, you know, you can eat anything you want, you know, we got some supplements and that will take care of the problem for us. So two problems, two main problems. Now I want to get into, sort of elaborate a little bit on where I ran into this situation. As I said, when I went, left home and went to graduate school, Cornell University, my doctoral dissertation was on the subject of advancing the cause of protein, and that meant animal protein. My research involved cattle and sheep and trying to figure out ways to actually increase the production of animal-based protein, because I thought, we all thought, that was really important to do. If we're going to improve on American diet, the more protein, the better. But in that, during the course of that work, and then subsequently when I was at Virginia Tech especially, I was involved in with my senior colleague, I was involved in coordinating a nationwide program of feeding malnourished children in the Philippines. And we went to the Philippines, poor country, like other colleagues who had an interest in that thing. We went to the Philippines to improve on the health of malnourished children. Malnourished and starving children. And the story was in those days that one of the most important things we could do was to make sure they get enough protein. That's why they're having malnutrition. So we went to the Philippines to make sure they got enough protein. That suited me and suited my colleagues because, you know, we're all living in that world. Protein is really important. We've got to get these kids enough protein. On average, the Philippines, they were using less protein. So we worked on that, and I happened to have seen without getting into the details, had an observation, I learned about it on a golf course one day playing golf with my friend, that there were few families that were consuming enough protein in the West, I mean in the Philippines, like we do in the West. But their kids of those families were actually more likely to be suffering from cancer, one kind of cancer, liver cancer. So it turned out among the few families who are getting enough protein, they're the ones that asked for myopression. Seemed to have children that were susceptible to getting liver cancer. So then this study came out. I mean, it was a crazy idea. I mean, we're going there to make sure they get more protein. I'm sort of seeing this crazy idea that, you know, elevating protein in that society could be a problem. So then this paper came out in India showing that when animals, experimental animals in this case, are exposed to a carcinogen that starts the cancer, if you will, and then they have two different levels of protein. One is the higher level, the 20% regular levels, that's the generally recommended levels. And then another group fed a low level of protein. These investigators at that time thought that if they wanted to protect these animals from getting cancer after being exposed to this carcinogen, the best way maybe they could do that was give more protein. So they were thinking more protein would protect against getting cancer. That was the idea. That was a hypothesis. But you can see here, this result here, I mean, it's dramatic. The animals who got the higher good levels of protein, 100% of them got the cancer. The ones fed the lower levels, which we should think was deficient, not good, none got the cancer. And so, now, two ideas, sort of, two observations came into play. One, I'm sort of looking at these kids, wondering what that's all about. You know, kids getting more cancer because of consuming more protein, and then this. Put the two together, that's really what led to my research career. Because I came back and said, you know, I want to know something about this. Does protein really turn on cancer? So we got a grant from the National Institutes of Health, specifically the National Cancer Institute, and I had that one grant. I had other grants too, but I had that one grant for 27 years, and it continued through the years. And here's what that did for me, in a sense. Using experimental animals, and I know that's a problematic issue these days, but this is the only way, looking back on it, even today, it was the only way we could determine biological plausibility. What's that, you say? What's biological plausibility? Well, this gets into epidemiological theory. The relationship between cause and effect, you know, let's say you think this thing over here, this nutrient, causes this. Get that impression. You call it a hypothesis, right? Well, to get some proof of believing this really causes that, we have various and sundry kind of observations we tend to make. There's one no criterion that stands out, and unfortunately missed by a lot of people in science, that we call it biological plausibility. It's one thing to see a relationship, but it doesn't mean a whole lot, because it might be something else. The way to get that evidence, you have to go and figure out, how does that work? What's the mechanism? That's what this research did for me, because I wanted to know first, are those Indian workers right? So we wanted to do some work to see if they were right. Does high protein increase cancer? And the second question, how does it work? This is really fundamental, because this gets into the basis for the entire drug industry, let alone the basis for the nutritional effect. Okay, we got those observations. Now, I want to show you, here's what we did over the next 12 or 15 years. I want to see how does it work. Let me just show you something here that's kind of neat. Anyhow, this is increasing protein, increasing cancer. See, I haven't digested this yet, no pun intended, because coming from, you know, the background it came from, and not really wanting to believe it in a sense, still, it was there. It wasn't like you need to turn your back and walk away. But actually, the Indian workers did walk away. They didn't believe their own research. And they tried to do some more research to show it was actually the opposite effect. And they didn't know anything to the contrary until I went to India and invited to go there 25 years after that, and had to show them that, in fact, taking the alternative route had a lot more something to say about it than what they had chosen to do. Okay, well, the first thing we did, we looked at the formation of cancer early on, first 12 weeks, right? Cancer starts with a genetic mutation. That's generally accepted by everyone those days and still today. That's the way cancer starts. So one group of them fed 20%, hopefully that's going to protect them from getting a cancer. Right? See that? Huge difference. That was a huge difference, just like the Indian workers have done. We're not discovering anything new here. All we're doing is sort of showing that, you know, got the same result, but it was spectacular. That's a huge effect. We also did it in other ways too, not just early cancer, but later cancer. We found that this protein effect is huge in terms of its effect on stimulating cancer. Then we did this. Say, okay, what happens if we go in there and we change the protein in the diet back and forth, switch the diets to see how things go? Give 20%, the cancer is growing, then switch it to 5%, turns the cancer off. Back on again, back off. I have to say that was very dramatic and maybe one of the highlights of everything that we were involved in over the years. Because not only did that effect exist, and it was major, and it was showing what a major nutrient could do when it fed too high. The other thing, we were learning something about cancer, which another hat I was wearing at the time. I wanted to know how cancer worked. we could actually turn cancer on and off. That's what led to. We could turn cancer on and off by just adjusting the nutrient content of the diet. That's a big deal. That's a really big deal. Stop and think what that means. Because most cancer in the human or human population generally is in reference to, you know, chemical carcinogens in there in the food causing it. No, it's not. But sometimes we talk about genes being responsible for cancer. No, they're not. They start with genes, but it's not the genes that give rise to the cancer. Maybe we talk about viruses causing cancer. These are some ideas that have been out there forever. But we never really talk about the enormous value of nutrition to turn cancer on and off. That leads, if this is true, here's what sort of came into view. If this is true, we could turn cancer on and off. Think about that in the human context. So that's what this was really referring to. And we went on to do a whole lot of things over the years to talk about that. So I got to a point of saying, okay, we got what, we kind of proved the first point with the Indian work. We showed the same thing what they had gotten. You know, protein turns on cancer. Big deal. Then the second thing was we wanted to know how they worked, as I said a couple of times. Now, learning, you know, how cancer, how does that protein do it in a biochemical sense inside the cell, if you will? We work with this kind of model here where cancer, this is the working sort of working model we use. Cancer is initiated, then over some years, it's promoted. That's how the cells grow and grow and grow. It may take several years. And then finally, at the later stages, cancer now is metastasizing, it's going to the wrong places. In the case of humans, we get diagnosed with it. And so these are the three phases. So the first topic was, we'll look at the first phase. They say, well, you know, maybe the high protein is doing something in that very first stage, turning on this cancer thing. Maybe that's the deal. So we started looking for things. And I can't go into the details here. If any of you chemists in the group would talk about it, I'd be happy to talk about it. But we found out, let me just summarize it quickly. The higher protein diet caused more of the carcinogen, that's caused the mutation, more of it to come into the cell. Well, that's pretty, maybe that's the answer. The high protein diet caused more of it to get into the cell. But then we found out also, the higher protein increases an enzyme in the cell that activates the carcinogen to cause it to have a mutation. So it's increasing this mutation. That's the second measurement. Third, it changed the structure of the enzymes to also cause it to do the same thing. The high protein diet also increased the amount of the carcinogen that binds to the gene that causes the mutation. So the high protein diet in these different ways all working to increase the amount of mutations that are occurring. Very, very, it's consistent with all these different ones. We couldn't tell which one of those was the key mechanism. So they're all working. So I said, okay, let's go to the second stage. We got into that, and we saw the same sort of thing. Let me skip the first one. First, the high protein diet causes these cells to die, bind faster, grow faster. That's not what you want in cancer, of course. So it's doing that. It's increasing the amount of a hormone to cause these cells to grow faster, too. It alters I can't get into all the details here. It increases the amount of the so-called free radical oxidation, which causes it to progress. It does things like, you know, alters calorie use. But here's really what was neat about this. Our bodies normally have a capability to repair problems that occur. In other words, a chemical comes in and causes a mutation, right? In other words, it binds to the DNA. At that point, our body is doing this millions of times over every day because these kind of things goes on. It repairs that DNA problem. Our bodies actually do that in a normal state of affairs. It's repairing all that DNA damage. Fascinating. Our bodies are really clever. Over all the years of time, nature's figured out how to protect us against this mutation thing. Most of the mutation, like 99.9999% or so, are prepared. But one every once in a while kind of escapes through. And now we have a mutation in the next generation cells. So our body has this enormous capacity to repair damage. But you know what the high protein did? The high protein diet actually compromised the body's normal ability to repair. So to hear on the one hand is pushing this cancer forward like this, and on the other hand is it basically going and disrupting the cell's ability to correct the problem. And you sort of say to yourself, wow, the high protein does not just turn on everything, it's very selective. You know, it's causing the cancer to go like this, and the body's ability to stop it, the high protein diet is blocking that too. So it's getting, you know, from the rear as well as a frontal attack. The same thing happened during this stage. This first one here, the lower NK, that's natural killer cell activity, it's immune function. Our bodies, once we get a little cancer cell in our tissues, our immune system has the capability of recognizing these cancer cells and goes and gobbles them up by what is called natural killer cells. It's a normal thing. We're all very happy. We should have this kind of thing. It works well. But the high protein diet compromises that too. So I'm saying to myself, holy smoly, this high protein diet, everything is doing, whatever mechanism is involved, it's basically just pushing the cancer forward like that. And compromise the ability of the body to take it back. At this point, I'm saying there's no way around this argument. I don't care what research is done through the years, whatever nutrient, other nutrients involved. The fact of the matter is a high protein diet will turn on cancer, period. That's the way it works. But that wasn't really enough, if you will. So the other idea with this second phase here, this is reversible, just kind of a reminder, because that's what we're doing when you turn cancer on and off. You feed protein within days, certainly even within hours. All those mechanisms start to come into play when you consume a high protein diet. It kind of, you know, cranks up things. It makes the cancer more likely to occur. So, sorry about that, I'm not putting this very well. So then we said, okay, so protein does that. Can we learn something more about this protein? Well, the protein we were using is casein. This is the main protein in cow's milk. The main protein in cow's milk. We tend to think it's the ideal protein of all the proteins we have. It's animal-based and all that sort of stuff. And that's what turns the cancer on. And I have to say, casein is easily the most relevant chemical carcinogen ever identified. So before we go too far with that idea, I'll show you there's one qualification that, but that's what casein does. Other animal proteins sort of doing the same thing. So all of a sudden it's coming into view here. Animal proteins are not so good. The protein in animal-based foods. Soy and wheat protein, here's a new plant protein. We put that into our model and tried it. Soy and wheat protein, new plant protein, didn't do it. So here, all of a sudden, there's a big difference here. The animal protein turning everything on, the plant protein turned it off. So you get this sort of contrast, if you will. And this occurred even when these proteins were fed up at the 20% level. It didn't turn on cancer. That was really quite exciting to see that. Now I'm going to just add one more wrinkle to this. It's really important. We also wanted to know, well, okay, we're using 20%, we're using 5%. How does that compare with what we're really eating, in a sense? How much protein do we actually consume? It turns out that, so we did an experiment. 4, 6, 8, 10% protein, the cancer is not turned on. What that demonstrates is protein is good stuff. We need protein. Doing all the good things, but not doing the bad things. That's what we're here. Up to about 10%, everything's fine. But once you go above 10%, that's where the cancer occurs. So I have to modify the comments I just made. Protein, when fed in excess the amount needed, here's what we need. Protein, when fed in excess the amount we need, that's what pushes cancer. So then you have to ask yourself, well, what's excess? Where do we get excess protein from? You know, do we actually consume excess protein? So let's have a look here. It turns out the normal humans, most of us, 95% of us, are consuming protein in this region here. We're up here in the sort of danger zone. At least we're at risk for getting cancer by consuming protein up at this level here. So let's explore that a little bit further and do it a couple ways. This kind of curve, I can generalize without getting all the details, that relates to the risk of various kinds of diseases, not just cancer. It's worse for heart disease. It's worse for cancer. This tends to work for diabetes. It works for a whole bunch of different things. they got that over here, and here's the protein up to that 10% or so, if you will. That's when diastasis begins to occur. Here's what the thing I just did. So how does that compare with the amount of protein we need? Well, we only need about 5 or 6% protein. That's the minimum amount we need. That keeps us all in balance and quite nicely. We can use a little more protein without getting any difficulty, but that was determined in 1943. What's that, almost 75 years ago. It's been repeated many times since. We don't argue about that, really. That's the minimum amount of protein we need. Then, we don't live with that level there. We actually have adjusted, our scientists before my time, of course, have adjusted this upwards by a couple of factors to get us up to make a recommendation to the general public. And so the recommended dietary allowance, or an RDA, is up around 8-10% protein. So that's the ideal level of protein. Because we're not zero, we're not getting up in here, we're just down, everything's working just fine. We're getting all this nice protein and doing the right thing. So what does that mean? How does that translate to every, well, for one thing, here we are. The average protein intake in our society is this. Come back to that, 17-18% if you will. It turns out plant-based foods provide all the protein we need. Plants have protein, good protein. So it shows all the protein we need, but we like to get more, if you will, right? Let's say we don't consciously, nobody consciously thinks about this, I know that. But collectively, as our subconscious minds, we're sort of, we want more protein, because we always heard that was true. So, we put in some animal foods. We might get up to 20% add all the animal food. But here's what really happens. Oh, I got the wrong slide here. Well, I guess we'll tell you what you did. Okay, let's say we increase total protein up to about this level here. We add all this animal food. What really happens, and here's a key to this entire discussion in many ways, all this extra protein, animal-based, it's coming from animal food, it has its own set of mechanisms that works on it. When it comes up to here, what it does, the total calorie intake is kind of constant. It pushes down the consumption of plant foods. So when we consume a high protein diet coming from animal foods, we're doing two things. We're getting two bangs for the buck, in a sense. We're turning on cancer, heart disease, diabetes, all kinds of other things, and we're actually decreasing the consumption of plant foods. Put those two things together, we see really major effects in terms of disease formation. And so then you can ask, okay, what's so special about plants and animals, those two kinds of foods? Well, if we look at just, here's a bunch of different kinds of nutrients, most of them, antioxidants, and complex carbohydrates, and vitamins, is that protein. These first three, vitamins, complex carbohydrates, that's what prevents cancer. That's good stuff. It prevents heart disease too. So plants have all this good stuff right here. There's really nothing, virtually nothing in animals to give us this good stuff. Plants have protein and fat just like animal foods do. But we have the right amount, more or less, in plants. And we have much higher levels than animal foods. When you put this whole picture all together, with all the details filled in, and see, you see what animal foods do, and you see what plant foods do, you put it together, we're in trouble when we start eating animal foods that way. It's so convincing, whether you're looking at, and some of this information is very old, it just got ignored. I'm going back to the literature, and just recently going to be publishing a story about the history of this field. So throughout this entire history of the last 100 years, every time somebody came up with research, to show us the problem with protein, animal protein, it was ignored, forgotten, or diminished, and just kind of went out the door. So, I'm skipping over a bunch of stuff, but I wish I had time to tell you this, but I just want to emphasize two things about the diet. A bad diet, it creates heart disease, cancer, and all the other things you can think of almost, is promoted by consuming too much animal food and too little plant food. Put the two together and kind of a major effect. And so that's where I was when we got our work came and got quite publicized about 25 years ago in the New York Times, and that's when this gentleman here, Dr. Cole Heselton, I didn't know him at the time, picked up the phone and called me after he saw our report in the New York Times. And because he said he'd been doing something along these lines with people with heart disease. And he had done that on his own. We didn't know each other. We were coming from two different directions, in a sense. And he got these results here that just some years later that was shown in the Force of the Nine, as a matter of fact, he took eight, in the first study, he had 18 seriously ill heart patients. Over 27 years, okay, this is the time Force of the Nine was shown, so technically not been published exactly this way. But in any case, he had 18 seriously ill heart patients, put them on all food, plant-based diet. Actually, he was using dairy in the beginning until we started talking, took the dairy out. So after a couple of years, these people added 49 coronary events prior to the study. They were all with advanced heart disease, as many of you may know. He puts them in this vegetable diet, fruits, grains, and stuff like that. He went from 49 coronary events in those individuals down to zero over the next 12 years. I mean, that's a big effect. That is so huge. He was attributing this primarily to saturated fat, maybe cholesterol. I'm convinced that's too narrow of a slice of the pie. It's looking at the whole thing, like we were seeing, like just described, that really works. And after 27 years, approximately, cancer rates were almost nil at the same time. Anyhow, he can tell you more about that. You have an opportunity to hear him. How many of you heard his paper? Some of you have, sure. We measured a lot together, and so he's kind of sort of stuck working on heart disease, mind, and the cancer, and science, and stuff, really hanging together very nicely. Just recently, he published another paper a year ago, you may have heard of it, about a lot more people, 198 patients that he's been counseling for 5 hours only, and he turns them loose, and then goes back years later and asks them how they're doing. All heart patients. And a single 5-hour consultation between 2 and 7 years later, he goes back and says, how you doing? It turns out 177 actually were staying with this diet. That's an 89%. Compliance rate. That's pretty impressive. All he's doing in 5 hours, he's saying, here's the way you do it. You know, here's how his wife gets involved and is shown the kind of food. And it was one of the first emerging kinds of studies. And so it turns out of the 177 people here over the next 3 to 7 years, only one person got heart disease. He was actually a friend of mine. He actually passed away. And I had sent him to Dr. Heselton. And he was said to be compliant. He said he was compliant, but I mean, you're talking to his wife, who said that wasn't really quite true. So he lost the battle. So look at this. This is less than 1%. Even if you accept it, the effect of diet on reversing heart disease is nothing less than dramatic, let's face it. Those individuals who chose not to do what he suggested they were doing, 62%. That's huge. So I just can't emphasize, there's lots of other data I can show you like this that really, at least impresses me and many other people, at least the whole concept of doing a reversion program is kind of special because it just causes all kinds of changes very quickly. Here's a summary of a bunch of different diseases that my son Tom, who now is a physician himself, by the way, Rochester. We got into the literature. I was at this point in the late, what was this, early 2000s. I was really obviously getting very impressed with how powerful is this effect, not heretofore to really discover. So I wanted to go back into the scientific literature and say, is there any evidence of this in past years that we've ignored? Sure enough, there is, and got ignored. People didn't want to pay attention to it. And so we summarized based on that kind of informal kind of survey of the literature. And so I got a bunch of diseases here that popped up, and many of them are reviewed in the China study, that some of these diseases, as you can see, are very serious. Some are more nuisance kind. All these diseases, the whole food, plant-based diet, there's evidence to suggest that it either prevents, suspends, and stops the course of the disease, or actually reverses the disease in question. And so this, I was really overwhelmed when we sort of got to that point, realizing that this kind of nutrition is so powerful, not only causing major changes in things like heart disease, reversing cancer, and things like that. All of these things work the same way. So at least a couple of comments here. First off, it's affecting broad. That's exactly the opposite of the pharmaceutical industry. The pharmaceutical industry is trying to take one nutrient, that's, they're looking for one mechanism. That's why this mechanism story became important. They're looking for one mechanism, creating some kind of chemical to hit that one mechanism that supposedly will stop the disease. That's what they're looking for. In a cell and put in a pill. It's not broad, they call it targeted drug therapy. That's the term they use these days. This nutritional effect is broad, the opposite. Now focus on one thing, let nature do its course. Working through an infinite number of mechanisms, they're very rapid. This can happen within a week or so. We can see this kind of change. And this change is sustained, which, I mean, you all know that you can't, you know, sort of use this diet to treat a problem you may have, and then go back, maybe go back and eat the wrong food again. If this is not that kind of treatment, when you do it, you have to stay with it, you just do it and keep on going like that, because if you go back, then the disease is going to come back again. You have to stay with it, so lifestyle change. So if the dietary change is sustained, and I'm suggesting that probably one of the most exciting dimensions of this information is the fact that this kind of diet is a means of treating disease, not just preventing it. We've heard before about our grandmother's tolerance to eating vegetables and all that sort of stuff. This is about people who actually have illness or sort of symptoms of possible illness, and then going to this diet and correcting the problem and reversing it. It's a very exciting concept. Here's what happens, and this is something that Gwen referred to, that my older son did, and now many others are starting to do the same thing. This is just a sort of sample of information. What can happen in 10 days, whole food plant-based diet, intake of more 16 individuals, in this case, this is one study he did, it's just gathered some information on it. They lost 5 to 10 pounds, and I think many of you can attest to that. This is what happens. The total cholesterol dropped from, it wasn't too high in that group, it was 196 down to 148. The drop in, average drop in cholesterol was very impressive. So that's a lot, really, in 10 days time. The LDL cholesterol, bad cholesterol, 118 down to 86. Triglycerides, 130. I mean, that just can be done with a group of people that I'm sure you are now getting familiar with your jumpstart programs and so forth. If you do the Bob Nessie before and after, this is the sort of pre and post kind of results you might expect to see. And this was done reasonably formally so we could, you know, get this kind of information. I think this is almost my last note. I just wanted to throw this in here too, because this is something we've known for a long time. If one plots, as the late Professor Ken Carroll did in 1975, if one plots the consumption of animal fat, let's forget the protein for a moment, animal fat with breast cancer or colon cancer or heart disease, as he's done, he gets a really impressive relationship. Go right to the origin. Originally, he just discussed fat. But then when I knew him just before he passed away, and I was invited to comment on his work, and so I suggested this alternative explanation that it wasn't just fat that led to all the information about fat, it was really animal protein, because the two are really coupled together. So, and there's no threshold. So what this is saying is that in different countries around the world, as they start putting in animal food, animal protein, you can see that's irrelevant. That cannot, you'll never see a study, for example, to show that as fat and protein goes up from animal food, diseases actually go down. You won't see that. That's the distinction between a whole food plant-based diet and any other version of the diet that I first talked about. Any of these other kinds of diets cannot do what the whole food plant-based diet can do. And I think you would agree it's a really impressive relationship. So, summary. We can treat illness with whole food plant-based diet. And the more I see, especially since, you know, when I have to tell you, when my son and I published the China study, I didn't know exactly how to present information. I had a lot of things going on, thinking about this, that, and everything else. I didn't know for sure that we could actually write a book, a story that could more or less represent this information. But since the book was published, and the number of groups that I've spoken to, and the other groups who are getting involved in this, I'm really overwhelmed. The effect of this whole food, plant-based diet is so impressive. A lot of that I've actually seen since the publication of the book. But anyhow, it's just a simple solution. Treat illness with this. What this means is that individuals can now take responsibility for their health rather than having a third party look after our health. We can reduce health care costs. I think that's a fair statement. By 70% to 75%, and it can be done quickly. Just imagine the total cost that we're now incurring because people are not doing that. You can also increase demand for healthcare services. The question now is, and this is why this program here is why what you're doing and others, is who's going to tell the public? There's lots of different ways of doing this, but I think one of the most effective ways is simply show people that the food could taste good, and then maybe do a pre and post kind of analysis for people who choose to do it. And I'll finish on this note here. We have an online course that some of you have already spoken to me, told me you're taking a course or thinking about taking a course. This is a course that I taught on the campus in the 1990s and finally was put online in a rather rudimentary form. My students did that, and we got it going, and it's been online now for a few years. We do it. It's our nonprofit organization here with Cornell, the Cornell arm of this. And Cornell has offered more than 200 and some courses in the online format. Ours is number one of the 200 and some courses they've taught at the university. So we've had a lot of success with it. We offer 30 Category 1 continuing medical education credits for doctors. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Have you seen any evidence of a whole food plant-based diet helping with diseases that have to do with collagen production, such as Ehlers-Danlos?
The question is, have I seen any evidence of the whole food plant-based diet having to do with collagen production? I know that's sort of one of the newer discussions that's out there on the internet right now. I don't know of any evidence specifically. To my knowledge, and I'm sure that research has been done. But, some questions like this arise from time to time about some specialty kind of thing. But, every time that this diet is tried on something new and different, it seems from what people tell me, even if it hasn't been published, it's a beneficial thing. All I can say is, I'll bet that it works. The effect is now so broad and biochemistry is so sound that if anything, won't necessarily do it, but if anything, it will improve it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So with all this evidence, what do you think is the obstacle for why NIH or CMS or all these health agencies, why aren't they promoting this more?
I think all of you heard that question. Why aren't the smart guys from Dallas, promoting this? That's what the book Whole is all about. After some years, I'm lecturing around to medical schools and get some nice opportunities, a lot of them. And one of the most common questions I ask is just sort of like that. Why haven't I heard this before? Why aren't the professionals doing this? So I did sit down and try to see if I could say something worthwhile in that book on Whole. And I haven't gotten a chance to show that here, but I'm really now excited about the idea that the way we tend to think about nutrition, and that's the ones in the professions as well, the way we tend to think about nutrition, one nutrient at a time. We determine how much vitamin C or vitamin E or protein. We look at each individual nutrient, how much we need. And we focus on that, like that's good science. We make food labels on packages, one nutrient at a time, right? we talk about the value of food in terms of how much nutrient they all have. And we spend a lot of money and time on this. We do research one research at a time. I have a way now that's working quite well, and you heard some of that on the ship last week, that really does, nutrition is not a science of individual nutrients like that, studying like that. It's all together. And there's a way of looking at that, and it's sort of like a systems analysis. Because when you look inside of the cell, we have